was the season that was, and now our task is to review it and look at transfers to get the squad in better shape. Is what I normally would be saying, but we've kind of made the decision that after winning a domestic treble in the last episode, the time is right for us to try and leave Southampton. How you doing, everybody, and welcome to part 22 of Club 3 here on My Career on FM 23. I'm Stu. Thank you for joining me in today's video, the final post-commentary video, where hopefully this will not happen again, where we're going to sum up the season with the season review, and then we're just going to see what happens from there. The idea is we're going to be leaving. I have already recorded the majority of this episode. The end of the episode actually hasn't been recorded yet, so that will be under normal circumstances, but we'll see where we get to. But if you're excited to see how the season was and what we do in this video and see what club we might end up at, then do not forget to leave a like on the video for me and subscribe so you don't miss any of the nonsense coming out of this space right here when he remembers not to have a microphone disconnected. Should we get into the season review? I think we should. Starting with the new arrivals. Andreas Schelderup is definitely, I think, the signing of the season. Superb. You can see the appearances and goals and assists on the screen just there. 30 assists is the final amount, by the way. I did mention a couple of episodes ago. When you see the amount of assists he's got, oh my word. Yeah, 30 assists. He's been fantastic. Orlando has also been pretty good. New signing from Manchester United in the summer. Not in the summer, in the winter. Sorry. Was it in the winter? Yeah. Yeah, January is winter. Yeah, sure. £95 million spent. Lots of money, but could turn into a lot of player. £50 million for Schelderup, by the way. Badiashile was the next signing down. As you can see, spent £55 million on him. Solid central defender. Really, really happy with that signing. I'm actually going quicker than past Stu there. I'm like the Flash. He was a rock in defence, pretty much. A bit concerned about the fact that he's a tight marker, but we got away with it. Antonio Silva was the other defender that we signed. A lot of money was spent on him, and to be honest, a lot more money than I wanted to spend on him. He's really not been that good for us, if I'm being as critical as I possibly can, but he did okay for us. After him was Rayan Aitnuri. I just get that right name wrong all the time, his surname. Rayan, let's go with him. Signed from PSG. Signed as a backup left back. He did backup left back things. Very happy with him on that. Started some games, made some sub appearances, happy days. Enzo Feta was next. We signed him on loan from Liverpool. Solid ball winning midfielder option to come in and just fill a gap in the squad. Did the job that was required of him. We then signed Thiago Almada. Cost us a bit of money, but we signed him on loan from Real Madrid just to cover the gaps when we used Veloso as a deep line playmaker. Didn't happen as often as I thought it would, so maybe we didn't need to make that signing. But a bunch of players went out, including big names like Marcus Antonio, Sebastian Bourneau, Manuel Ugarte, Andre Lunin. Thank Christ we got rid of him. Darian Marles, Aaron Hickey. We got rid of all of those guys for decent amounts of money. That allowed us to buy the expensive players that we did without having to worry about too many of them on instalments. So we did some good business there. Sam Barnes left the club for Burnley. And we got rid of some of the players that we didn't use as well, including the likes of Francois Heralds and Stanisic. We had to get rid of those guys because they just weren't playing. And when they did play, they didn't perform. In terms of the season, well, where do we start? First in the league. Club wanted us to finish top half. Well, we overachieved on that just a little bit, didn't we? Pinamonti, with 23 goals, was the third highest top goal scorer in the league, doing a great job. The average home attendance, it should be higher than that, but remember, we didn't have the full attendance for all the season because we did upgrade the stadium at the start, so that is pretty good going, can you consider that? But we were fantastic. Only the three losses all season, best in the league. Our attack, I think, was the best, and our defence was the third best, which is about consistent for where it has been the whole year. Much better. Before, our attack was the best, but our defence was actually usually mid-table, if that. So it wasn't very good at all, but a fantastic season. There's nothing we can really say that sums it up other than that. It was an absolutely superb season. So, job well done. You can see the fixtures there. You can see the few losses that we had, but we won so many games. And in the end, just, I think that early season form and then that period just in towards the end of the season before we got right to the end of it, kind of mid to late season, those two periods did the job. Champions League, they wanted us to get to the league stage. We already did that because of circumstances. I can't remember the reason why, but we were meant to be in the Europa League, and because of something in the league, we ended up in the Champions League, but got through to the quarterfinal. We got past Juventus, who knocked us out last season, but Inter Milan did the job on us in the quarterfinal. So we know who we've got our eye on in the future. But yeah, fantastic job all around. FA Cup, won that one. Because of course we did. Really easy run. Cambridge, Bradford, Peterborough. Then we had Newcastle and Bournemouth before finally settling on Manchester United. But we did very, very well in the games where we needed to. We got squeaked through the games where we didn't play well. Did a great job. Speaking of great jobs, Carabao Cup. We avenged last season. Leeds and Manchester City as the first two games. Beating Man City 7-2 was ridiculous. So a bit of a tougher run. Beating Liverpool in the final as well. Chef's kiss. Moments to remember, 7-2 against Man City, as mentioned before. What a performance that was. Beating Barcelona 3-0 in a game you guys didn't even see because I thought we were just going to get battered. What a performance that was. And then the goal of the season was a James Ward-Prowse volley. And I already have seen this goal because obviously I've already recorded this once. So I'm intrigued to see it again because I can't remember exactly what he looked like, but I remember thinking, actually, that's not bad. So, as usual, we are going to have a look at it. So let's go into the game. I say let's go into the game. I've got no hands at the moment. It's post-commentary, don't you know? Let's load the goal up. Or let's watch past Stu load the goal up. And we'll see what it looks like. I remember it being a bit of a stunner, if I can be so bold. So it's February here. Shelder up gets it, tries to cross it in. It's deflected. And Ward-Prowse just decides to run in on it. I mean, I have seen better goals. But he's hit it on the volley. That is a strike and a half. And he's got it as far over as you possibly can. He's got it as far over as possible. He's hit the post and gone in. Like, it's almost unsavable. It would have been better if it was top corner because it would look more spectacular. But still, technically, a very sound goal. It's got the Stu seal of approval. Seal of a Stuval? That's terrible. We haven't grown in reputation at all, which is a bit of a concern because it will limit the amount of top quality players we can sign because not all of them will want to come unless we're 4.5 star. Money-wise, most things are up. It's just our broadcast revenue is down, which I don't really understand, but sure, it is what it is. And in terms of shirt sellers, we've got Pinamonti as the top one with Shelder up, Veloso, Ward-Prowse and Tapia as the guy. So we've got a good mix of international talent and the homegrown boy, James Ward-Prowse, as well as older established superstars and young up-and-coming wonder kids, which I really do race. I went through the finance bit a lot quicker than past you did, I have to say. But yeah, I am concerned about the continental reputation. It's good, don't get me wrong, but I would have liked to see us with three trophies this season grow up a level. In terms of the team of the year, it's your standard team. Hoyenhan and goal, Jimenez, Badiashile, Cresswell, Thomas. I would have had those two the other way around. Cresswell and Badiashile. With Tapia and Levere in the middle, Palmer, Veloso and Shoulder up, supporting Pinamonti. Probably make an argument that maybe Palmer and Price are in a bit of a battle there. I think had Jay Leithan, who is injury prone, had a whole season, he could have forced his way in there as well. But Cole Palmer, I mean, some of the goals he scored were just so important to our campaign. I can't describe just how good he has been in big games, genuinely. In terms of accolades, manager of the year, I think for the third year in a row, which is pretty insane. I will take that. In terms of the player awards, Veloso was Fans Player of the Year, Young Player of the Year as well. Signing of the Season, you know, was Shoulder Up. As with Goal of the Season, you know that was James Ward-Prowse. Pinamonti with most goals, 38. Most assists was Shoulder Up with 30. Player of the Match awards was Shoulder Up with 10. A bit surprised he didn't get Player of the Season, if I'm being honest, when you look at those stats. Highest average rating also was Joe Veloso. If you pass me, can scroll down, thank you. 7.4. And Kiarman Guardian with most passes completed per 90 minutes. In terms of the competition awards, did we get any? I think we got one. Yes, we did. European Golden Shoe is Andrea Pinamonti. That must, again, I was thinking about it at the time. I think that's yearly. It's not seasonally. So I think that was for 2029. Because it would have been Erling Haaland because he outscored us. Someone else did as well. I can't remember. It might be Van der Weven, who's at Manchester United. But in terms of record breakers, Shoulder up with assists, Toyin Halt with clean sheets, and Orlando with his transfer fee. Because marvellous. I'm really hoping Orlando turns into a superstar, especially for that money as well. Like, that's so ridiculous that we spent that money. A few quotes about how good the season is and dynamic timeline time. Not going through it. I haven't planned to go through it in the original video either. I will try, I don't think I remember the last time I said this, to put something in the top corner to link you back to the full playlist. If you haven't seen us from the start, go back, watch how we were at Dartford, through to Tranmere, through to here. fitting, because it might be the last episode of here, but quickly looking at our period here at Southampton, we've made kind of a conscious decision to sign young talent, but also sign big players as well, as far as big players that we can get. So we have smashed our transfer record a few times. We have brought in some more established players, but we are very much focused on the future. Players like Cucciara, Gardien, Tapia, Veloso, even though he's not a new gen. Like, we've focused on so many young players. Thank God Abaje, Paris Walker-Hughes, Linton Hamnett, and Sam Roberts are the next gen guys. Abaje was the guy who was eighth. He was in the top 10. There's the four. I forgot that that had come up, actually. So, yeah, excellent. Right, so that's that out of the way. Now, I'm going to be completely honest with you guys, and I'm actually going to return, if I can, to the big camera. So let's go back to that. So at this point, I'm going to just edit bits in rather than do what I did before, which is just show the whole video and post commentary over it. At this point, I was kind of looking at the team and thinking, there's probably no point in doing anything. Like, we had a quick look at the supporter profiles, which have changed a little bit, but not by a lot. You can go back and pause it if you want to have a look at that stuff. We sent ourselves to America again for a pre-season tour. We just accepted the club vision and expectations because we were basically thinking we're going to leave the club. So we waited until job offers came up. And that brings me neatly to this part of the video. So we noticed a couple of big clubs that were without manager in the form of Manchester City and Liverpool. Now, I'll be honest, my ideal thing at this moment was, do we go with Manchester City or Liverpool, who are Premier League clubs? We're going to be repeating the success that we've already done, but we'll be able to do it a bit easier because we'll have the ability to go out and find the world-class players out there, and we might get a bit more money as well. Our transfer budget at Southampton is around £60-70 million, so yeah, it's one of those things. So my ideal solution was to go abroad, but there wasn't any decent jobs. The best one there is Sociedad, and really, I'd go for someone a bit better than that. So made the decision that I was going to apply for both jobs rather than wait for someone to come to me. So for the first time in the save, we are actually applying for jobs. You can see here, I don't know if I declare interest straight away. I have a bit of a debate about it as well, because I know obviously when you can apply for a job or declare interest in a job, it can upset your current club. I declare interest in the Man City job, as you can see. I give it a quick read over just because I know it's worth looking at. And actually, to begin with, I only go for the Man City job. I then talk myself into the Liverpool job. The reason why is very, very simple. Liverpool rejected me last season. It's a little bit childish, I know, but Liverpool did reject me last season. I was approached by them. I interviewed with them. Their Guardiola sacked by Man City, and also the manager who they hired over me last season, Liverpool, decide to sack him, which shows how good the decision they made when I won the Premier League. So I'm thinking to myself, Premier League won, FA Cup won, Carabao Cup won. I am going to be so desirable as a manager to have done that with Southampton. Poor, I tell you what. So I've applied for the Man City job already. Spoilers, I do apply for the Liverpool job as well. It hasn't actually happened yet. I'm sure it will in a moment, because I think I did it literally a couple of days later. I just decided, you know what, I'm just going to cover all my bases. Do I do it here? I'm looking for job centre, and I go to training for some reason, because of course I do. I look for Liverpool, and I kind of have a bit of an internal conflict here, think about it, if there's any other jobs, and I decide, you know what, let's just declare interest and apply. I think I just declare interest at this point. I don't actually think I apply, which is a bit weird, but I think here, because I see leading candidate, that's what tempts me. I see the words leading candidate, and I think to myself, well, I'm the leading candidate. Maybe, just maybe, I should go for it in that case. And I actually end up deciding to do it. I mean, I genuinely thought it was going to happen in this clip. It obviously doesn't want to, which is really frustrating. Stu, get a move on. Apply for the job, man. Do it. Do it. So I don't know why I can't find it, but for some reason I can't find it. But as you can see here, we do eventually get offered interviews by both Liverpool and Man City. There is also, at the time of this, the Chelsea job as well. Now, I rule out the Chelsea job for a couple of reasons. The main reason, however, is that they just have such an old squad. The rebuild there would just be so big. And we're already into the end of June by the time we're hearing about these interviews. It doesn't leave us with a lot of time. And just the overhaul of that Chelsea squad, it was too much with not enough time to do it. Also, the season actually feels like it starts relatively quickly this year. The Community Shield game, which as of recording, I haven't actually played yet, that feels like it's going to be too far away. Now, when I say I haven't played it yet, what I mean is it hasn't happened yet. Because obviously, you don't know which club I'm going to be playing for. I'm in for two jobs. There might be a third one yet. Who knows? But yeah, that game actually hasn't happened yet. So we haven't properly started the season. But it's like on the 3rd of August or that week of August or something, which I don't know. Maybe I'm being ridiculous. It feels really early. But yeah, we got all of the information. We kind of go over all of the kind of questions and stuff, very similar to what we did last time. I'm trying to avoid making promises because I don't want to get sacked. Because again, I'm kind of treating this as real as possible. I don't want to get sacked from a club because I've overreached. I want to go in and say, you know, I'm good at what I do, but I don't really want to sell them up the river because they will sack me and then I'll be unemployed and they'll have to build myself back up. Now, we go through their culture of the club. Liverpool don't really have a lot. In real life, they obviously do. But in terms of this interview, they don't actually ask for a lot. So I'm kind of on the fence as to whether I take it or not. Based off of that a little bit. But then I'm thinking, actually, I do want to leave. So, no, it's absolutely fine. So I can't actually see what that is. I think it's £88 million, £68 million, something like that. It's a very comparable transfer budget here to what we've got at Southampton. So initially, I'm kind of looking at that thinking, okay, that's not actually all that really, if I'm honest. I kind of wish it would be more, but beggars can't be choosers at this point. I've committed to leave. Let's just accept that we're going to be taking that as a transfer budget. So the Liverpool job, I mean, I'm going to take it if I get offered it, but I do have that thing of, I mean, they're not really being very open with me, and that raises a bit of a red flag, if I'm being completely honest. But it is what it is. Now, Man City. We do the interview immediately after. I literally have hopped on a train from London to Manchester, not London to Manchester, Liverpool to Manchester. And we're having the same interview. Very similar interview, very similar stuff. They are a 5-star reputation club. Liverpool are 4.5 reputation, which does mean they will be expecting more. And you'll see when we get into the promises. See, I avoid the promise there. But when we get into the club culture and what they expect and things like that, there is a lot more on there. So we do need to kind of knuckle down and make sure that if we get this job, we are on our toes. So we go through all of this stuff. We get to here. Obviously, they want us to do a lot of things, including signing young players and developing them and selling them for a profit, which does make sense. Manchester City do that every now and then. But I associate them with just signing players and doing really, really well with those players. But they want us to do a fair bit. Remember, this is the team that has been dominating the Premier League, other than 2 seasons, for the entirety of the save. Save for the second season in the save against Liverpool and season just gone against us. So we're the team that's knocked them off their perch. We're also the team that's like beaten Liverpool to the EFL Cup as well. So transfer budget is huge. Absolutely huge. Over £170 million. Yes, please. I'll have a lot of that. I would very much like that if that's okay. So yeah, we do that and we accept everything and we just wait at this point. But then we get that email saying that we are the favourite. Now, I have had a look on the staff page at this point. I'm not the favourite. So I don't really know what the game's on about. There's two guys who are favourites for each of the jobs. One is Fernando Torres for Liverpool, for Christ's sake. So I don't really know what's going to happen at this point. But I am committed that we are going to be leaving Southampton. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to come back on the 1st of July. And I'm going to show you what we've done at the club, assuming we're still here at that point. 27th of June, the chances of us getting hired between now and then are very, very slim. So we'll probably still be at Southampton. Spoilers, we are still at Southampton. But I'll show you what I've done with the club in the meantime while we wait to hear back from both of those interviews and see which of those clubs have hired us. And the answer to that question is absolutely nothing. We haven't done a single thing at the club to the point where I even had to quickly set up training and put in some friendlies because I had done absolutely nothing to the club whatsoever because I was determined that we were leaving no matter what. I was absolutely adamant that I wasn't going to be staying at Southampton just because we'd achieved everything. I've loved my time here. Let's not get that twisted. I've absolutely loved my time at this football club. But it just feels like the right moment to leave while our stock is the highest. I mean, we've got the list of games there. You can see fixtures coming in. And there's the early game. Again, it is the 3rd of August. I was right. So the Community Shield's on the 3rd. Again, that game hasn't happened yet as far as I'm concerned. I haven't got to that point where if I am at Southampton or if I'm not, I would have played it. So Luke Thomas is happy. We've managed to cure his disgust for us. I can't remember the reason why. A few people wanted contracts as well, which we kind of just gave them at this point. Police going past my house. Excellent. There was armed police on my road the other day. You don't need to know that. We're in a bit of the wilderness at the moment. And also, I'm just waffling on absolute rubbish. Also, there's a mug in front of my light. I am just waffling on at this point. Offering contracts. Don't really care about the amount because in my head I'm thinking we're leaving anyway. I'm going to take you through to when the wheels started to fall off in this transfer window. Wheel number one, didn't get the Man City job. Interview unsuccessful. They went ahead with Simone Inzaghi. I am still a very, very inexperienced manager. I've got 8 years of experience in the job. A lot of the managers who get the big jobs have a lot more experience than that. So as frustrating as it is that we didn't get it, I kind of understood it. I was not happy, don't get me wrong, because I was kind of looking and thinking, oh no. But then I was thinking, okay, Liverpool turned me down last season. I've got more on my CV this year. There's a chance that they'll still hire me. I still think they'll hire me. Because actually, we are in a... I mean, Man City are a bigger club at this point in this save than Liverpool. So Liverpool might be like, okay, we'll go for the young plucky upstart. You see me applying for the Inter job there. That was a panic move. But I was also looking and thinking, they knocked us out of the Champions League this year. Their squad is decent. I know that it is. And they offered me an interview straight away. So automatically, I'm like, results. We're in, boys. We are in. I'll be honest. The second I had applied for the Inter job, I had my heart set on that one. Because what had I said? I kind of wanted to go abroad and experience something different in this save. So... But the money would have to be right. Because again, if I got offered a job to go to Italy, the money's got to be good on it. So we go through the motions. We go through all the transfer stuff. All of the interview stuff. The transfer budget, I think, is similar to Man City and similar to what we've got. It's about 70 million or something like that. I think it comes up in a minute. Club culture stuff, I think I just agree to it. Yeah, I do just agree to it. And we say that we'll do the expectations. And yeah, £80 million. Decent transfer budget, not bad at all. We could probably get some value as well. The wage budget is very much broken on this particular interview. And that's that. So, bad news, didn't get the Man City job. Good news, still in the running for the Liverpool job. And possibly good news as well, we're now in the running for another job with Inter Milan. So, fingers crossed, we get one of those ones. Well, that leads us to wheel number two falling off. Liverpool didn't want me either. But all is not lost at this point. As annoyed as I am about the fact that we didn't get the Liverpool job and that they've rejected me 2 years in a row, I then declare interest for the Inter job because, you know, it's not going to hurt. I do have in my head, Inter Milan. The job abroad is the one you really want to do. That's the one you've got your heart set on. You wanted to go abroad. You wanted to test yourself in another country. So all is not lost. The next time you see me, we are going to be the Inter Milan manager. Hopefully. Should have probably pointed out that I was on a tricycle in this imaginary scenario of wheels falling off. Because the third one's fallen off. Inter didn't want me either. It was about 1 in the morning when I was recording this. And I was utterly despondent. I didn't know what to do because the entire summer was built around us leaving Southampton. And here we are on the 2nd of August, the day before the Community Shield. And there's no other jobs available. As you can see, the best job there is Ajax. And I did debate Ajax. If the job's available, I am still half debating it. But, yeah. The entire summer was built around leaving. We haven't left, and we've done nothing to the squad. We haven't sold any major players, but it's gotten worse because we don't have as many central midfielders anymore. Herald has left. We've lost Petter, who was on loan from Liverpool. and James Ward-Prowse is getting worse. And I don't really like Tamara. So we've got £60 million, but we've got all of our loan players returned. And also, we haven't bought anyone and the season's about to start. So I went into overdrive a little bit. I went and tried to do a bit of transfer business then. But I kind of had to commit myself at that moment. We're staying at this club. We are staying at Southampton for at least one more year, which is good because it builds on our legacy a little bit more. But that's the transfer business right there. And oh my word, I did not. I mean, I hadn't, look at the amount of transfer offers I hadn't responded to. I hadn't responded to them because I thought I don't need to. I'm going to be leaving. So yeah, and that's where I got up to in this episode before I realised that the audio I hadn't recorded. So the next time you see me, it will be with audio. Huzzah. And we're going to play the Community Shield in this episode. And we're going to discuss what's going to happen in the next episode. So bear with me a moment and I'll be back with you. Cannot tell you in how many words just how frustrated I was at the end of that recording session. I am calmer now. I am much calmer. I am looking forward to another season with this club because I do love the team we've put together. And just to point out as well, look, I'm here. It's actually me. This is not post-commentary. I'm actually here. Also, why is James Ward-Prowse an attacking midfielder? Get out of here, James. We don't want you there. I've got no idea why you're there in the first place. Why is Joe Veloso not in the team? Oh, I need to sort this bench out. 1 second. We're back. And we're back for the Community Shield against Man United. We're going to play that in this episode. And then we're going to wrap things up here. And then we're going to discuss what we're going to do further forward. So this is year 11 for a Community Shield game with the exact same 11 that finished last season with no transfers in or out whatsoever. It is Hoyer-Nahl in goal. It's Jimenez, Guardian, Badiashile and Livramento in the defence. Tapia and Livia in the midfield with Leithen, Veloso and Shelder up supporting Orlando up front. Yes, I'm going with Orlando. I'm also at the moment not having James Ward-Prowse on the bench because actually there isn't much room for him unless I get rid of Tamara. But I don't know, I kind of want to give Tamara a chance to try and advertise him a little bit more. So we're going to do that and we're going to see what happens. I think, yeah. Let's just see how it goes, shall we? I mean, this team was good enough last season. I'm sure it'll be good enough this season. And I have got some transfers in the works. I'm looking to bring in a... So something I didn't talk about in the post-commentary that I did in the original recordings. I'm looking to bring in a top-quality central midfielder who can be a ball winner. Again, similar to my thoughts last season, I think we've got deep line playmaker covered with Joe Veloso. He can do that role. And then we've got players who can fill in as an attacking midfielder. That is something we could look for if we've got spare money as well. But the level of play we want to bring in, I think we are going to be limited to what we can do on that front unless we move anyone on. So we'll see what happens, shall we? But let's see whether we can start the season off with the most important trophy of them all. Of course, I am talking about the Community Shield. We start things off with a Manchester United free kick. I can't speak. Van Duiven. That sounded like I was calling him a dweeb. Van Duiven. I can't say his name anymore. Him. Dutch guy. Yeah, him. All the game is going slow. But yeah, so it's been a weird summer. It really has. Mentally, I'm ready to be somewhere else. And it's very, very weird that we haven't ended up there. But it's not weird at all, actually. It's the first time in FM23 I've applied for a job. And I know from previous experience that applying for a job doesn't always lead to anything. So I think if it was the case that we had to leave, if we'd have upset the club... Orlando's just scored against his former club, by the way. I genuinely think we might be starting Orlando this season. He's been really, really good in pre-season. Pinamonti hasn't played that much, actually. Lavia nicking it off of their... like superstar signing Carl Ferguson. He's an American midfielder. He's very, very good. But Lavia's just like, yeah, I'm better, bro. Yeah, Orlando might be our starting striker this season. I haven't fully decided that yet. It's very early days to commit to that when you see the amount of goals that Pinamonti's got for us. But we need to give the kid a chance and we need to get him game time sooner rather than later. So we'll see what happens. But yeah, if we were in a bit of a tricky situation here at Southampton, if the club didn't want us to stay here anymore, if we were like public enemy number one, I think we'd be applying for any job and we could be considering leaving. We might even be considering jumping before we're pushed. Because although I wouldn't actually want to leave my job, in real life, what would I do? If I was in a job that I didn't like or a job that I didn't enjoy and that the club didn't appreciate me in, what would I do? I'll be honest with you, if I was a football manager and I was earning the kind of money that this game is saying I would be, I'd have saved enough up that I could take some time off. I'd probably leave. I'd probably turn around and say, if the club doesn't want me anymore, I will step aside. And Kvaratskhelia, it's a name I've been dreading to say for a long time, and I've just tried to say it, and I think I've butchered it. But him, he's gone and scored, and it's 1-1. Drama for the neutrals. It's 1-1 in the Community Shields. I was going to call it the final, but there's not like any other part of the game, is there? So it's just a Community Shield game. It's a nice goal from him. Hoyenhal probably could do better. It is what it is. But it is 1-1. Man United probably deserve that on retrospect. I'm going to say that we've been unlucky so far, and we're just going to have a chat with a couple of players below. So, not good enough. It was his mistake, apparently, that cost us a goal. Livramento, not good enough. We are playing him on the left because Thomas is tired. Jimenez, not good enough. Both of our right-backs having shockers out there. Guardian, not really playing to the standard I would like him to be. Do we make any changes early on? I think we might do. We've got 6 substitutions to make, actually. So, I'm debating maybe Livramento comes off for Thomas. We'll freshen him. I can't speak. Fresh in the back lineup. Veloso can come off for Cucciaro. We'll give him some football. And we'll leave it at that for now. And we'll see if we can just potter along and get another goal. That'd be lovely. Right. Let's demand more from the boys. Because we've played okay with the chances we've got. But we need to do a bit better. Especially in set pieces. Badiashile immediately tries to get things right. It's one thing that we disappointed the team on. We disappointed the team on, or was it? It was either disappointing the team, or it was one of the job interviews. It might have been Man City. It might have been the fact that they said your lack of commitment to performing well in set pieces, or something daft like that. Like, they weren't happy with our lack of set piece goals. It's like we were committed to doing set pieces. I've got the button ticked and everything. It's just we couldn't do them. Oh, Van Dweven has just gone through there, and Hoyenhal makes the save. Van Dweven's going to try and keep it in. I've said his name 2 different ways in the space of 5 seconds. There, great efforts, Stu. Consistency for the win. But Man United have been on top of us in this game, which, you know, is the natural order of things. Last season was a free. Hoyenhal comes and claims the ball, though, like an absolute G. Jimenez has not recovered, neither really has Guardian, but we have actually closed the gap on Man United in this game. We are looking a bit sharper, a bit better. Just going to fire the boys up and see whether we can just get things going. Look at how far forward our team is. I like that very much, giving them less options that they can have. If we can just press them to the point where they make a mistake here, it would be lovely. We're not far away from doing it, to be fair, but they do get through. Capitao, who I'm so gutted that, oh my God, I think they're about to score. Go on, Badiashile! Badiashile and Guardian, the partnership of dreams. They prevent a goal from Van Dweven. Oh my word. I mean, how is Guardian on a 4 after the teamwork he showed with Badiashile there? Right, substitute o'clock. Oh, that was the thing of beauty. Right, Guardian's coming off for Crowley Cresswell. Jimenez is just going to have to suck it up, buttercup, because he is just not having a good game. Luke Thomas isn't either, actually. Cucciaro is also not having a good game. Lots of people not having good games. Lavia can come off for Tamara. We'll give Tamara a run out in the midfield. And I don't really know what else to do. Shoulder up and Lethan. I'm thinking maybe one of those two. Could be both of those two, actually. We'll bring Ebrey on there, and Cole Palmer can come on this side. Lethan hasn't played badly. I do feel kind of bad just hauling him off. They will be our final substitutions of the game. But let's just try and change it, shall we? Let's just try and change it. So we're going to demand more from the boys. Come on. Final 10, 15, 20 minutes. Let's just go out there and just blow them away, shall we? Right. Gaye gets it to Benford. A little passing between the two. Benford, of course, a former Southampton player. He did join us for half a season on loan as an emergency left back. Good to see him getting game time. As long as he doesn't do anything against us, I'll be very happy. Right, Cresswell gets it to Tamara. Tamara chips it forward looking for Palmer. Palmer heads it down to Jimenez. Nice little show of possession here from us. Tamara now to Tapia. I wonder how the players are reacting to me applying for all the jobs that I have. And I wonder how they're reacting to me still being here after doing that. Like, that'd be crazy, right? Ball through to Orlando, and Orlando makes it 2. There was just something about that chance. Normally that wide, I would be like, no, not a chance. But for some reason, Orlando gave me the confidence that he was going to put that in the back of the net. And with 15 minutes to go, we lead again. Get in there, boys. Good stuff. We're going to stay. This will be the perfect thing to get me fully back on board with the project. Cucciaro with the assist through to Orlando. Changing of the guard, maybe Cucciaro and Orlando instead of Veloso and Pinamonti? It might very well be. Imagine Veloso becoming permanently a rotation midfielder, a rotation deep line playmaker in the centre of the midfield. It's a thing that could happen. We've got a deep free kick here, actually. Cucciaro Shorts to appear, but we give the ball away really quickly there. But we steal it back from them. And now we can probably build something. I mean, we've gone all the way back to Jimenez, which... Okay. I mean, that was not comfortable at all from Jimenez. Goes back to Hoyenhal, and we go again. We've kind of let United recover there a little bit, but maybe it's a double bluff. Tamara with a poor pass. Tried to get it to Orlando. Couldn't quite get it there. We are really kind of swarming around them, but they're just about starting to play out of it. Badiashile with the intercepting header. Jimenez heads it on to Palmer now. Palmer looking for options. Goes to Jimenez. Cresswell. I mean, if nothing else, this is buying out time. Tamara now looking for options. He is playing for his place in the team, but his pass is so bad that Jimenez has to head it to a United player. Should have let it go out of play, really. And all of a sudden, United, with Tariq Lamptey, have a chance. Van Dwyven! And it's such a good save from Hoyenhal. I genuinely thought that was going to be in the back of the net. Kim Christian Hoyenhal. I tell you what, he's not a European Championship winning goalkeeper for nothing. Internationals, by the way, not club. We haven't won the Champions League when you weren't looking. He was with the Norwegian team that won Euros. But you knew that anyway a couple of seasons ago. Yeah, he didn't win that trophy for nothing. I mean, they had a terrible World Cup, but we won't talk about that. I don't actually know. Oh my God, Van Dwyven has got a chance here. We clear it. Oh, that could have been a bit of an issue. Gotten away with it, though. We have gotten away with it, but the highlight continues. But Thomas intercepts now, and we go again. Febre goes out wide into Cucciara. Cucciara looking for Orlando, but Orlando just doesn't have the pace to get there. An Orlando hat-trick today, I think, seals his starting place for the first game. It's pretty much sealed already, I'm not going to lie, but it would really rubber stamp it. And we've got just added time left to go, and I think it's nearly safe to say... Trophy number 4 for Southampton at the beginning of season 4. I mean, it's the Community Shield, but I'm still very excited about that. Do I make a banner for this? I say make a banner. Do I update the banner and include this as a trophy? I think I do. It's the most important trophy in world football. I think I do. I really think I do. But yeah, another trophy. So, what a backwards episode this has been. The weirdest transfer special where we've made not a single deal, but we've ended it with a trophy. Utter madness is that. Absolutely fantastic. But I'm delighted that we've managed to win another trophy. And it's just good to show that we were under the cosh for that first half, but they just couldn't quite break us down. Got lucky a couple of times, but we ended up with a trophy. Number 20. Is that Tamara? I can't remember if it is. Whoever it was, they did a cartwheel, and that makes me smile. Very, very much so. Right. That's out of the way. Orlando scored 2 goals against his former club. Results. Congratulations, lads. So we've just won the pre-season final. So now move on to the start of the season. Start of the season, by the way, is against, if we double check, West Ham United, a team that we have historically beaten, but we do struggle with a little bit. So it is going to be an interesting one. But what we need to consider is what we do in the next episode. Because normally what I would do is do a couple of games as normal, just to introduce the season, and then play through to like around here. But actually, because we've not really had a transfer special today, what I'm thinking is I'm actually going to play the first few games of the season off camera, and we're going to come back for the Newcastle game, and we're going to go through transfers in and around there, and we'll do deadline day, because I think we're going to need that time to cement the squad in place. Because although the squad is not bad, in terms of central midfield, it's Lavia, Tapia, Tamara, and Ward-Prowse. Tamara and Ward-Prowse aren't good enough. I mean, Tamara, I'd like to move on. I've got him on the transfer list already, but he's only 3-star. He's not going to get any better than that. I think I'm going to need to reduce his asking price, if I'm honest. But, yeah, I think we're going to need to bring at least one more player in. Not two, but we're definitely not going to be able to bring in two. And certainly not two high-quality permanent transfers. So, I have got players in mind. The ones that I have offered for... I've been narrowed down to one, actually. I forgot about this. Dylan Veenstra from Milan. He's not wanted by them, if I remember correctly. He's transfer listed for 57. I think we've actually got him under that, yeah, £50 million. For someone who can be a defensive midfielder and a playmaker, I think he'll be ideal. His tackling is decent enough. His passing's pretty good. He's just an all-round good midfielder. We're not looking for him to be a ball carrier. We're just looking for him to be a good, solid tackler. And the best bit is, he's not going to be someone who's going to be good enough to force himself into the team just yet, but he could be in the future, so he could replace Lavia quite nicely. And then, of course, we've got Veloso as the backup here, and we've still got a few other players as well. Like, We need to work out what to do with Linton Hamner. He's a 2.5-star player, so to me, he's good enough to be in this first team in some capacity. We've got Nick Carter, who's a left-back as well. He's probably not good enough. We've got Harry White, who I don't think is going to be good enough either. We're probably going to move those two on, if I'm honest. They did have better potential, but it has gone now. So we definitely need one central midfielder. I'd like another attacking midfield option, if I'm honest, but I don't think we're going to get that. But in terms of wingers, we're still overloaded. We've got Leith and Shoulder up, Febre, Price, and also Palmer. So maybe Febre gets his chance at playing as an attacking midfielder a bit more this season. Maybe he does. Who knows? But that is going to be something for next episode. So again, I am going to play through up until Newcastle. We'll play Newcastle, and then we're going to have a look at transfer business and try and work out what we need to do. And we'll play through deadline day as well. Doesn't look like we need to do any transfer business. We might just play the Leeds United game. But we'll call an audible on that when we get to it. So, thank you so much for bearing with me in the last few episodes, by the way. I know that they've been a bit different. They might have been a bit more fun, to be honest with you, because of the craziness of them. But I do appreciate you sticking with them. And hopefully, that mistake isn't going to happen. Same mistake, I didn't make it. But hopefully that doesn't happen again. And we just don't ever have to deal with post-commentary again. Because I don't really like having to work on videos twice over. But I will see you in the next video. So until then, thank you very much for watching today's video. Do not forget to leave a like on there for me and subscribe so you don't miss any of the content coming in the future. I've been Stu. You guys have been awesome. And I will see you in the next video. Cheers.